The work of Byron Katie, The Great Undoing, may be the most profound experience you've ever stepped into. For those of you who are new to the work, what you hear may sound radical. It is not always easily understood at first and may be interpreted as unkind or uncaring. We invite you to be very gentle with yourself, and through this work you may find love beyond what you have ever experienced. Those who allow the work to serve them have found that relationships radically improve, stress becomes a thing to laugh at, and peace the fundamental ongoing option.
The whispers in the morning from lovers sleeping tight.
There are few people who don't have questions and issues around sex and relationships. What happens after boy meets girl? After girl finds knight in shining armor? What happens after, and they lived happily ever after? How do we do the happily ever after? In the work lies the answer, if you allow it to serve you.
I'm in the middle of a relationship where my partner is attracted to someone, and you know, it just seems like, no, it's not okay. It's really not okay.
It's not okay with you.
It's not.
Yeah. And it's not okay with you. It's not for your highest good. Can you know that?
I do know that, Katie. I absolutely know that. I mean, I don't want to be where you are. I mean, I'm kind of like what just happened with Corinne and the next woman. I just like... No.
It was just a question. The right answer is the one you come up with. If that's the one, I'm for it. I want what you want.
I don't want to live in the in-between. I want it either all and done completely, totally, without any pain, or I want to have my old life back before the work, because that feels like what ruined it. And I want y'all to do the work on it, so that I don't have to say all the things.
What was the word again? Hopeless. Yeah, you're the one saying all the words anyway, sweetheart. All those words, they're inside of you. We say words, you put meaning on them, and that's inside of you. It's all you. So it's not for your highest good or his highest good. Or her. He's seen another woman?
Her, she, Yara, right here.
Okay. So it's not for your highest good that she is seeing someone else? Is that the scenario?
It's making my life totally crazy.
Okay. She is not supposed to see someone else. How do we know that's not true?
I know that that's the right answer. I know the right answer to say it's what's happening.
Argue
so
with it, you lose. You're calling her your discomfort, and it's your you are your discomfort. The belief that she should be attracted only to you, that belief is your disharmony, not where she goes or what she does. That's it. And you can argue with that and lose. Mankind's invited. We've been doing it for centuries. What do you get for holding the belief that she should focus on you and only you?
Well, when she does it, I get to feel good, really great. And when she doesn't, I feel miserable.
Yeah. So when she focuses on you, is that part of you there that doesn't really buy it, that thinks she would rather be with someone else? Like with her lover?
You mean now?
Or her friend.
Yeah. Now, yeah, now. It didn't used to be that way.
And the way that that happens, yeah, she was living your belief system.
Right.
But the way that it happens, that you don't feel secure when she is focused on you, or appears to be focused on you, is because you manipulate it. You threaten her, you get angry, you get moody. So when she does focus on you, you don't buy it, because you can't believe that she came to you of her own free will. All you know is you've been manipulating, and you think she's responding to it. So it's empty. So you can't even know when someone loves you as long as you're holding these belief systems or even cares.
Okay, I'm with you. I'm with you that far. You've said before, you know, I'm monogamous. Okay, so if my partner's not monogamous, then I might say, well, sweetheart, I love you, and...
If you want to hold on to that belief instead of her, yeah. That's what you're holding on to, is this belief, I'm monogamous. And if that is your truth, then it could cost you your lover. It could cost you your friend. But you can't know that either.
So it's really okay with you if Paul does anything?
Oh, sweetheart, I love him. How could it not be? His happiness is my happiness. Silly me.
I wish I were that evolved.
I don't see it as evolved. I got tired of the pain. Like every time I turn around, he was right in front of my face. And I mean, he's right there in front of me, and I couldn't even connect because of this system that we're talking about right now. And then when I let it go, I could see the insanity of thinking he should want to be with just me. Well, I'm not including his happiness in this formula whatsoever. So how can I know about happiness if it doesn't include him, his?
If it's your highest truth in the moment to want to have a monogamous relationship and your partner doesn't, then what do you do?
You hold on to that concept, or just honor that truth, and he'll either come or go, or she will either come and or go. If you hold on to your truth, that's what you've got going. And then when you lose that friend, then you take a look at your belief system again. It gives you a whole other view of it. And it may be that you keep it, and it may be that you reconsider. You know, what will you do to get what you want, and what is the cost? Are you willing to pay the price? But with me, I don't have to worry about it, because I'm always monogamous. I found out what that was. I'm connected to that within me, and that's what I married. And so to go outside and believe that there's even a Paul, a husband, breaks the contract of that within me. So immediately I'll show you how monogamous I am, you see, when I go out there for him. I go out there to marry him. Then I have divorced that contract to stay present with that within me, that I am. So that's true monogamy. So that's why we want you to stay with me and no other, is because it's closest organically to, it's the closest metaphor of that within me. So it gets real confusing when we go into the material world. And then we can say, well, have all kinds of lovers, have a lot of them. We're all one. Okay? And that can work for some people, you know? We just inquire. The body is going to do whatever you want to follow your mind around so that you can see your mind. Body follows mind. Truly, yes. If Paul would be happier with another woman or other women, that's what I want, because that's what I've got. Reality. I marry that. And I want his happiness. He's me. Because when I argue with it, I hurt. Haven't you noticed, sweetheart? It hurts. And then what do you get for holding the belief? You strike out at the one you love. And you tear down everything so you appear to look better. And it never works. Big heartache.
Okay, sweetheart. This is kind of, well, it was done earlier. And there's a piece of this that I keep...
So Nina, let's begin.
Okay. Yeah. And I mixed it together. It's men, my father, and God. It's kind of interchangeable.
Yeah, it's all the same.
Okay. I'm saddened by Andre because he comes on with such passion and sincerity and then he disappears. I'm angry because he gets so caught up in his own bullshit that he can't see me. I'm saddened by Andre because he opened my heart with empty promises and then disappeared. I'm angry at my father because he's getting sick and he's my last family member.
That's the story. It's this lonely, abandoned story. It's showing up everywhere.
Yeah. So just be there. Just be there until it moves through.
I'm really frightened of being an orphan. Yeah. I'm really frightened of the fact that everyone's dead.
Yes.
And so I meet someone and I... grasp. I like glom onto it because it's like salvation, you know.
Yeah, I do. I do. So just stay until it moves through, honey. Just honor it.
I don't want to be alone anymore.
Yeah. Oh, sweetheart, you know, some people have cancer, you have this. Yeah, this is the big one.
I just became awesome.
I don't like Andre because without him I felt that my life is on hold. I'm saddened because without him my life feels empty. I'm angry at God because he always seems to set me up for loss.
Yeah.
He dangles the jewels of life in front of me and then takes them away.
Yeah. Is this your worst nightmare?
So, you know, I feel all this love for this man, and some part of me really allows for whatever he is going through, and then there's this other part that can't reconcile with the need.
Yeah.
And I have so much shame around how much need there is.
Yeah. Oh, sweetheart, you look shameless to me. You know that some of you received the postcard for Easter and they put ears on her? Did you see that? Rabbit ears on her. And I said, good you did that. It shows. It proves once and for all I have no dignity. It's all nothing. No pride. Yeah. No shame.
My heart was hurting.
This is a big story, you see. You lose the last relative and you have no past. There's no one to validate that you were even born. You see, I mean, where are you going to go for a past? I mean, who are you going to suck into it to hold it up? So, you know, let's get a lover and start a new past. So I'm going to say, isn't that true, honey? He'll go, yeah. Remember when? Yeah, there's a past. But it's terrifying to be without a past. And with that last relative, there it goes. No one to hold it up but you. And then it becomes very terrifying because you don't believe it either.
I seem to be more frightened of like the moment to moment, day to day. Maybe that's the same thing.
Yeah, it's not moment to moment. It's thought to thought to thought. Uh-huh. There are no moments. Yeah. Even the now is a concept.
But can we go into that a little bit? The now is a concept? Because now what I see is four empty walls. When I come
You home. Would. You know, you heard it on a record somewhere, read it in a book. Yeah. I was going to say, put a picture on the gun wall. Yeah, that's what you would have to see, because you don't know the highest order is to have no one. That's the highest path for you. It's like a recipe. And this is your he's the potter, you're the clay. That's it. This is the recipe for your highest spiritual good. Exactly like this. And you know that's true. The proof is when you argue with it, it feels like a death. So this is it. So we just keep doing the work until we love the walls. Okay, Angel. You know, until you... look at the next one.
Okay. I'm open.
Here. Yeah, you sure are. You sure are. You know, I'm just loving, Nina, how you're like a flow, like the breeze. You'll go into the sadness, into the laughter. It's just, you see a flow?
Yeah.
It's just flow. Just total expansive. Look at the next one.
Okay. I want him to be constant. I want him to be consistently present with me.
She's hearing analytical there. You see, the turnarounds are your prescription for mental health. And as some would say, physical health. You just live the turnarounds.
I want him to make me feel secure. I want him to show up. I want him to stop running away. I want him to take care of me.
What happens when you're with someone is you focus on them so you don't have to experience what's arising.
Ooh, that's so true.
So it's like, bring me anything. You know, what we do with alcohol and drugs, we do with people.
Yeah.
So just bring it in and keep it going so I don't have to deal with what arises. And alone is what you obviously need. And it's that space where you do the work. Because
yeah.
It could be that like in 10 minutes you meet the one, the apparent one that you will be living with. Mm-hmm. And the space that you've been gifted, you know, it has to be done another way, not as comfortable as it could now. Now is always the highest good. Mm-hmm. It's always a gift. It's, am I going to realize it and love it? Take full advantage of it, of the gift? Or am I going to seek outside myself and yank it from me in the name of I know what's best? So, and there's nothing you can do to get a partner, and there's nothing you can do to get rid of a partner.
I keep hearing it. And yeah. I'm hearing it.
Yeah.
You know, I am hearing it.
Yeah. Those of you that want a divorce or don't want a divorce, there's nothing you can do about it one way or the other. You just tell the story about how you have something to do with it. That's all. We're in the perfect place in the perfect time, always.
Should or shouldn't do?
Yeah.
Okay, same stuff. He should be with me. Mm-hmm. He should get out of fear and open his heart.
Yeah.
Or what do I need from them? I need him to make love to me. I need him to continue what we started. And I need him not to be lonely.
Yeah.
What do you think of him? I think he's powerful, sensual, sexy, beautiful, tuned into his heart, mysterious, uncontrollable, God damn it, flaky, generous, not dependable, fickle, brilliant, strong in my love.
Yeah.
I don't ever want to experience his disappearing act again. I never want to experience waiting for him again, or the loneliness in my life when he's not around.
Yeah. Okay. Let's begin.
Okay. I'm saddened by myself because I come on with such passion and sincerity, and then I disappear from myself. I do that to myself, and it's such a dichotomy, you know, it's like it's so extreme, because I move into these states of really being in the flow and aware, and then I go into that fear and lonely space, and I'm so terrified of those empty walls.
But you go in and out according to your story.
Uh-huh. Okay.
And so you go into the story of alone, you go into tears. You
right.
go into the story of something you like, and you come out of it.
Right.
It's like we move in and out of our stories. That's what emotions do.
Huh.
You're not stricken with a feeling. You're not struck with a feeling. God doesn't strike you. Nature doesn't strike you with a feeling. It's an effect of that, that you know when you're in and out of resonance, in and out of your nature. You know, and you can't change the story to feel better. You know, feeling better ultimately is who you are without a story. And you know what I say, keep the good ones. You know, have a good time. If it hurts, do the work. You know, they take care of themselves when that mechanism wakes up. You know, it is like a virus. You could have, you know, this lonely thing. My experience is I am alone. And I'm so entertained with myself. And I am also the trees and the walls and the grass and the pavement. Like I'll get up at 5 in the morning, 4, and I'll go out and I'll just move into the earth, into the pavement, and the dogs and cats, and the garbage cans, the sounds, and the night and the day. And I am the one I go with.
I am the one I go with.
Heaven. The same as this. It's so profound. It's inside of me. This is my internal. Yours. I'm you. So stay in the work. But you go out and reach for another in your mind to entertain yourself and keep yourself occupied. And awareness is what we go for. All stories are good. It's just meet with some understanding.
I really feel what you're saying.
Yes.
And I really, what happens often when I come here too is, and that's why I really wanted to get up, because I move into the resonance.
Yes.
It seems very easy when I'm here, for whatever story I tell myself.
Well, we'll hold you in this womb until you, you know, until you are the, you're aware of you are the womb that holds you. Welcome. And you know, that's what the center's for. You know, if you think you don't have family, give us a call or bring your body. This is a great story, and here we are. Yeah, come mother us. Come be our lover. This is what you do best, you give. Not take. Same balance. Let's look at the next one.
Okay. I'm angry because I get so caught up in my own bullshit stories that I can't see me. Oh, boy.
And there's another one.
Okay. I'm angry because I get so caught up in my bullshit
and
stories
his.
That I can't see him.
Good.
Oh.
Good.
Or that I get so caught up in his bullshit stories that I can't see him or me.
Can't see you.
Can't see me. Oh, I do that. That's where I go.
He says his bullshit story. Say, I love you and I'm never leaving.
Yes.
And
that's the one.
And what does that have to do with you? He's telling you his story. My husband says, I love you and I'm never leaving, and I say, good. And then he walks out the door. So I tell the story of he went to empty the garbage, hunky-dory. I tell the story of he's gone forever, and sadness. So who would I be without my story? Present. Married to the thing in front of me. Which is me. If you take out the word time, no one leaves.
I don't get that.
If you take out the word time, he's never left. He's never been gone.
And on a certain level, I get that, really. That he's here.
No one can ever leave.
Huh.
So when my husband can't. He can't leave me. He's only been in my mind anyway. He's my story, so how could he ever leave? And he takes his body away, here he is. And when we're standing, we could say body to body, he's still just my story. He dies and he's still just my story.
I hear what you're saying, and I still love the reassurance of a body in front of me.
Mm-hmm. Oh, well. I was just about the time he's totally devoted, never going to leave, and it's really true, a truck hits him. You have no control. Don't you get this?
You know what this place, it was a place that's trying to grasp anything to hold, because I feel like I'm free-falling.
Mm-hmm. Good.
Yeah.
Free-falling's good. If you jump out of a plane and the chute doesn't open, it's scary maybe for a moment, but there's nothing you can do, so it's over. And you just enjoy the fall. And for some, it's like the first we could say, story here, the first freedom that's ever been felt in a lifetime. But what's happened is the line has been drawn in the sand. It's total acceptance of reality. That's all it is. Total acceptance of reality thereof. And we could say in the story, they come to it the way I came to it. It hurts not to be. What is, is. I can't make the chute open. I may as well just free fall. And in that is bliss. You don't even care if you hit the bottom. It's equal. You don't even bother projecting it. The fall is so good.
Where am I? Oh, I'm saddened by myself because I opened my own heart with empty promises and then I left. I don't like myself because without me I felt that my life is on hold.
Boy, is that the truth.
I'm saddened because without me in my life, it feels empty. I'm angry at myself because I always seem to set myself up for loss.
And now we know how, specifically.
Yeah.
We think he should stay when he's walking out the door.
Yeah.
You know, you set yourself up with a lie.
With a what? With a lie.
A lie.
Yes.
Yeah.
I'm angry at myself because I'm getting sick and I'm my last family member.
Oh, God. I get that. Wow. Oh, wow. That's really cool.
Now I am my last family member.
Oh, God.
Oh. You just got a whole family, sweetheart. You're an entire family. Let's go to the next.
I want me to be constant, to be consistently present with me.
Yeah, I really do.
Well, he really is your bare image, isn't he?
Yes.
Yes. All that love you pour out for him is for you also. But not dependent on the others, so you can come to know you, come to know that, whatever you come to know.
I want me to make me feel secure. I want me to show up. I want me to stop running away. I want me to take care of me.
And there's only one way to take care of you. Take care of your mental.
By telling myself the truth.
Yes. Telling yourself the truth and then living the turnarounds. And look forward to messing up so you can do them again. So you can finish this.
Yes.
In the moment. Now.
Yeah, you saw me going like, I'll finish forever.
Yeah.
No, it's like, can you just do now?
Yeah. He should be with me. Oh, I should be with me.
He should be with you. Can you really know that that's for your highest good?
No.
And what do you get for holding the belief?
Oh, a lot of pain when it doesn't show up.
Yeah.
I fight with what is.
Yeah. And who would you be without the story?
That he should be.
That he should be with you.
It's such an intricate story. Mm-hmm.
And who would you be without it?
Is this like generic he or he specific or just the story of he?
He. Let's go into the full thing.
Okay.
The full dream.
Like Andre he.
Yes. Andre, who would you be without the mythology that he's supposed to be with you when he's not.
I don't understand, because the honest response is that I know on a certain level, but I don't know. My mind just goes blank. Who would I be? It's been like my lifetime story. It's been my salvation story. So
yeah. So you see how she's doing this? He's really going for it. How would you spend the rest of your life without the story of you need her, you need him, when they're not there?
So who would I be?
You don't even know. You don't even know. That's your story.
Yeah, that is my story. I've had glimpses, of being here and just being in the fullness, but I don't know.
How would you live without it? You don't even know what to do with your hands. It's been to attract.
That was the first clue.
Who would I be without the story? Not even a clue. You'd be like a child, a toddler. You'd be like a baby. Crawling. No plan.
Falling.
Free falling. Mystery. It's like you unfolding.
That feels very beautiful.
Yeah, that's my experience. I used to walk into people's houses knowing that they knew it was mine, I knew it was mine, even though we'd never met, even though there was the story of the mortgage and a deed, but I could just walk in and it was fine. They'd give you water, they'd sit you down. That's what we do with children.
Yeah.
We say they're lost. They're not. I'm lost if I see you as lost. But there's a myth here that is so flimsy that we even need a big recorder's office to store these lies in. Who owns what? And again, as long as we're going to do bodies, that is his and yours is yours. And never the twain shall meet. Not ever. That's the attempt we make with our sexing, when it doesn't last. And then we try to get it with words. But ultimately it comes down to who would I be without my story?
Could you go into the sex thing a little bit? Because I want to fight you on that one.
Well, we tried the... Okay, so do.
Well... No, I see that's another precious, because I love sex and I love the connection and I love all that I infuse that with magic and mystery.
Yes,
and but I don't know another porthole that takes me there in the same way.
Well, this is not about leaving it.
Oh.
No, this is not about no sex.
Oh, okay.
No, life doesn't change. We're just looking at awareness. That's why more people don't go deeper into the work. They think it's going to cost them something valuable to them. But my experience is an extreme opposite. Everything gets richer. So, who would you be without the story? See, what happens in my experience is when Paul appears... It's grace. It's like the mystery just popped up. I'll see one, like seeing you. It just, oh my. It's amazing. I appear as this. I'm so fine. But if I focus here, when I'm called over there, it's limiting. Like this. And it's never too much. It's this. to limit is not who you are. Look at the next one. And an invitation again to do that, to go inside. It can take you in a while. Who would I be without my story?
Yeah. And I'm really drinking what you're saying.
Yes, I see. And you're drinking in what you're thinking, not what I'm saying. You're drinking in what you hear I say, not what I say. You're drinking in your interpretation of what you think you're hearing.
Where do we meet in the truth?
We don't. I'm you already. That's what I mean, my bodies can't connect.
Go to need?
Yeah.
I need him to make love to me.
Is that true?
No, I want him to make love to me.
Is that true?
That I want?
Uh-huh. That'll take you in a while.
I'm really honest about this. Oh, boy. Okay. Shall I go on? Because I...
Well, you want him, and what do you get for holding the belief? You want him to, what is it?
Make love to
you. To make love to you.
I get the pain of not having that.
And what do you do to get it? Look how you act when you hold the belief you want him to make love to you. Look how you treat him.
Yeah.
Look how you treat you. When you hold the belief you want him to make love to you.
Yes, I see. It's coming back here.
Yeah, interesting side, isn't it?
Yeah.
It's a facade.
Yeah.
It's an act that we put ourselves through to get what we want that isn't real. Mm. And my experience is, in awareness, it's the same thing, and with no fear attached, no wanting attached. It's just loving what is, and it's not limited to sexual contact.
Turn the tape over here. There's no need to fast forward to the end.
Did you go into it? What do you get when you hold the belief you want to... You want someone to make love to you. Did you see your action? What you say and how maybe soft you say it or harsh you say it or... Gosh, you may put on some perfume you're allergic to. You know, what do you do when you hold the belief that you want someone to make love to you? You know how a chameleon changes colors?
Yeah.
And then if it doesn't work, change again. Let's change strategy. This is what you get when you hold the belief you want all. Pleasure is pain. And then when you're in the penetration of it, or into the, we could say, the climax of it, that's the space where to play with it, where the mind stops and you don't have to look at what you did to get it. Like, this is real, this worked. But it's where the mind stops. But we do it enough and then we even think through orgasm. You know? We think it's not, well, whatever it is. You know, but this, it's like anything else. You'll learn finally to take that over too.
It has to own everything. This thinking has to own everything and take it from you. It has to. Otherwise, you'd be the awareness of love. And you wouldn't have to do anything for it. You would be it. The awareness of it that you are already. So who would you be without the story of you need any angel to come to you? How would you live without it? How would you live without that?
I'd be at peace.
Yes.
I'm just stuck with this one thing. What is wrong with just asking in the moment without attachment? You know, kind of...
Nothing, if you don't say so. You're the storyteller of it all. Nothing. But we don't just come out and ask. We're some of us. Because we might say what we're afraid of hearing, which is always the truth. And the truth is, we do want to hear it. Because it's the truth that sets us free. What is that? Maybe it's Mick Jagger that does, don't you love her face? Don't you love her as she's walking out the door? Look at the man.
Okay.
Let's turn that one around.
Oh, okay. I need me to make love to me. Or I need me to be who I am.
Yes. And that is making love to you.
Yeah.
That's the ultimate lovemaking. Mm-hmm. To skip the middleman and get it from there. Everything else is a bonus. It's the is. Giving you more than you need. It's called abundance. Yeah. It's true abundance. It's like, and that too? And that too? Here's John. The places we will go, my dear. And that too.
I really want that. I do. Overflow.
Well, you've got it. We're just talking about realization. Mm.
Boy, I'm so glad this is on tape. Okay. I need me to continue what I started. I need me not to be lonely. Okay, what do you think of them? I think I'm powerful, sensual, beautiful, tuned into my heart, mysterious, uncontrollable, flaky, generous, not dependable, fickle, brilliant, strong, in my love.
Yeah. Did you own them all?
Ooh.
Which one's the most difficult?
My love.
Yeah, you're the last place you look.
I never want to experience his disappearing act again.
I'm willing.
I'm willing. I'm looking forward to experiencing his disappearing act again.
Yes, so the one you love can become visible. You.
Oh. I am willing to experience waiting for him again and the loneliness in my life when he's not around.
Yeah. If my husband says, I'll be there at 10 and he doesn't show up, then I know there's a higher purpose. I just know that. Because he's God, it's God. This is God. And so I don't have to guess. Something better than him. And the beautiful thing is, it's unimaginable what could be better than him. And there it is. But the something in front of me is always better. I just know that. God is everything. God is good. Not sometimes. Every moment. Oh, Nina. Welcome.
Nina.
You're my family. Yes, Angela. You just can't get rid of your family.
Nina, turn that last one around. Reverse it. The last number six.
The last number six. I never want to experience waiting for him. I never want to experience waiting for me again. Or the loneliness in my life when I'm not around.
Thank you.
I'm willing. I'm willing to experience waiting for me again. And the loneliness in my life when I'm not around.
Yeah. I look forward to it. Yeah.
Okay, so feedback for this one.
Thank you, Nina. I really appreciate the work you did. I have a lot of issues with loneliness, and I just really appreciate all you went through. You did my work for me.
If you want to know if you're lonely or not, if it's true, go out into the desert and try to be lonely. Go out where there are no people anywhere and try to be lonely. Not very lonely out there, is it?
Awesome.
Awesome. Yeah. And if you want people, here they are. The whole world, here it is. And out there you begin to notice. There's my family. I mean, they're
loud.
They are present and accounted for. You see? And there's just no way you can be lonely. I mean, here we are. But the phone rings, and if it's not him or her, we get that lonely feeling. Well, it's God calling. You see? So we're just running a myth that would keep us from knowing that. Mm. Feedback.
It was just glorious to follow you to that place where you didn't know who you'd be. I hadn't really gone there before, you know, but I really was able to go there when you were doing that, and it was amazing.
Isn't that what we do here? We just keep the invitation always is to go into it. Go into it. Let's do the work.
I feel you're Captain Kirk and I'm Mr. Spock. I am saddened at sexuality. I'm saddened at sexuality for not knowing what to do. I'm scared of sexuality. I want sexuality to go away. I want orgasms. My sexuality should take over my body. I need my sexuality to come in.
Okay, let's look at it. You want orgasms. Is that true?
Well, I've had just really one, and it sure was nice.
Yeah. So, you know, you want more. Is it really true?
No, it's not true.
Yeah. You know, good, you get real.
Yeah.
You know when I want one? When I'm in it. You know, I wait.
Yeah.
I wait, because to want it can keep me from it. You know, I just... So I orgasm every moment.
I bet you do.
Yeah. I'm in a love affair. So when you're to have it, it'll be there.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah. And what was the next one after orgasm?
My sexuality should take over my body.
Is that true?
No.
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 And what do you get for holding the belief that your sexuality, or that you have any at all, or that there's such a thing, yeah, even? This psychology stuff, I don't get it. Yeah. Sexuality, what is that? Yeah. What is that?
It's society. It's for me.
Well,
it's,
yeah, but sexuality, yeah. I mean,
society says, I should, and it's just another...
But we teach all of these names, sexuality.
Orgasm.
Yeah, all of these names, and no one knows what it means.
Yeah.
You know, we have some definitions, but we're still messing with it. You know, I want, I need. My body should. I'm not normal. This is normal. That's not. You know, the attack on God every time. You know, it is... Find the way it is. Join that. That's an orgasm. That is sexuality. Every word, the word for God. If you wanted an orgasm, you'd be in a corner masturbating.
Well,
or asking someone here. If you really wanted one, it wouldn't matter if it's a man, a woman. You know, anyone that would know about those things. If I want an orgasm, I'm going to get one. Yet it's better to give one than to receive one. Yeah, that was it.
I'm not fully experienced at this yet, and I'm experiencing that I think that when Brian touches me toward orgasm, if I didn't have anything going in my mind, I don't think anything would move there. And I don't know that for sure. I play with it for a while, and then it seems that that's true. And then I would have, I'll just go for an experience of thought, this is for God. And then I could move to it.
And that's just one more belief. God wants me to have an orgasm. Is it true? And I hear you.
Right. So I'm thinking that it would,
yeah,
that it would mean nothing. I might, and I don't know. I'll just have to.
Orgasm for Brian, orgasm for God, let me orgasm for myself. So then it either comes or it doesn't. God doesn't want anything, in my experience.
Yeah.
He wants nothing. Wants nothing. Now, that's made in the image of God, that one, it starts creating an experience. You know, the mirror is down the line, and because it's in the image of its maker, and so what it wants... It gets confused with what it wants is itself, God. It's made in that image. But it starts creating over here because it has the same ability as its creator. So it starts creating the mirrors down here, the illusions, and longs for itself. So we have to come back to ourself to experience God. So over here, this one is out here and it wants. It wants. It wants itself back. And it's looking in all the wrong places. But God over here, he never wants. It's the original. And over here we can scream, God, help me, you know. And God is, you know, just waits. because everything is already the help. So it doesn't have to act. It is always itself. All of it, itself. So, you know, just playing off of, you know, it's, you know, God, it's God that would want it, and can I know that? And I like what you said about without a story. I, you know, my experience is the story is what brings on the orgasm. Without a story, there's no want, there's no need. It just is. So that could look like sex or not. So someone that just has sex all the time, they think they're doing it? I don't think so. They're just telling the story about how they're doing it or want it. But without a story, it starts to cease. That's when time collapses. But you always know that's happening ahead of time, but not consciously, so you're just simply moving as you're supposed to. You know, to use the statement to collapse time or to collapse the story, they're synonymous. Time is the story. The actual story that you've attached to, the thought you've attached to, that is time. You know, when you're asleep at night, you go to sleep at 10 o'clock, and you wake up at 7 o'clock, it was timeless. If you didn't wake up in between, you closed your eyes and opened them. That's it. It's timeless because there was no story going on. So it's the same in your waking. If you're not attached to a story, there's no time, no space, no place. So, sweetheart.
So.
So I would like to say we're not sure how it's done. It has been the story throughout the centuries. Okay, here's how it's done. Okay? A belief arises. It sounds like this. Read it.
It's the pettiest I can find.
I would hope so.
I don't like Thomas when he is physical or comes on or with Debbie. Fools
yes.
around.
Yes. Now... Now, Thomas is not supposed to do that. Is it true?
Of course not.
What is the evidence of it? People should not come on to people without your permission. Pretty hopeless?
Absolutely.
Okay, so what is the evidence of it? The reality of it?
That
he does.
He does.
He does. In your story, he does. That's the reality of it.
Mm-hmm.
So I want to ask you again. He should not come on to her. He's not supposed to. It's unkind. It's rude. It's all of those things. He's supposed to stop it. Is it true? No.
Of course not.
And for those of you new to the work, how do we know it's not true? Tomas is coming on to her. Argue with that.
Coming on is not even true. It's
yeah,
it's my interpretation.
Not his reality, it's yours.
Yeah.
Because we haven't asked him.
No, of course not.
But in your story, you see, the reality of it, it's happening. So, and then when I ask you, is it true that is supposed to, he's not supposed to do it, you say, no, that's the reality of it.
Mm-hmm.
So you're living a lie.
Mm-hmm.
What is, and there's nothing you can do to change it. Because you can go up and you can smack him or you can ask him not to, and then the minute you step off the property, he's doing again. What is. Mm-hmm. Okay.
So you shouldn't come on to Debbie or Sharon or any of my women friends.
Is it true?
Of course not.
So what do you get for holding the belief?
I get to feel a victim. I get to feel I get to feel abandoned. I get to feel alone. I get to feel separate. I get to feel hurt. I get to feel left out.
Yeah.
All these things.
And look how you live toward Thomas.
I leave him out. I'm separate from him. I don't see who he is. I don't connect with him.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
So turn it around.
I don't like me when I am when I'm physical or I come on
to women without their permission or when you know not to.
Okay. I don't like me when I come on to or I'm physical or come on to women, fool around with women.
When you know not to, without an invitation.
When I know not to, okay. Mm-hmm. Uh-huh. Yeah.
Yeah.
Get that.
You don't have an invitation, and you go at them to try to manipulate them into some kind of relationship, possibly.
Yes.
Rather than just being your attractive self and a friend and let it grow on its own.
Mm-hmm.
For some of us, that's okay. And what I'm hearing from you is you may want to take a look at it, if that's not okay with you. That's one of the boundaries
okay?
That you go... What is not you okay? Go past your own boundary when you do that.
Right. Got that. Yes.
That's all.
Yes, I'm not really.
So where's Robert? I mean, Thomas. Okay, sweetheart. So tell him. Read it. And
I don't like you, Thomas, when you are physical or you come on to Debbie or Sharon or any of my women friends.
So what we do here in the work, when we're doing like one-on-ones, which is how we live here, rather than live in secret, we live totally exposed here. It's called freedom. And it always is solved through, we'll come to see. So ask Thomas if that's his reality.
Is it your reality, Thomas? Is it your reality, Thomas? Oh, I'm sorry.
That I come on to Debbie? Come on would probably be too strong a word for me.
Go in, Thomas. It may not be. Just a yes or a no. And degrees we don't care about. Good.
Sometimes I do.
Okay.
Well, that's a relief. At least I'm not way off.
Well, don't you love to be right?
Yes. Yeah, unfortunately.
Yeah, look forward to being wrong.
Mm-hmm. I look forward to being wrong.
Yeah, it'll keep you in your business. So, the next one. Guide him.
Read it. I'm angry at me when I read. How did it read? Read it.
I don't like Thomas when he is.
I don't like me.
I don't like me when I'm
coming on to.
When I'm coming on to
Thomas.
Thomas.
Which is what you're doing right now in your mind when you get angry.
You're coming on to him.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Thanks.
You know, with your story, with your anger, he comes on to them, and you come on to him to keep yourself from being present.
Okay.
Keep yourself from the awareness.
I don't see coming on as seduction. That's all. That's my feeling of coming on is seducing.
Yes.
Right. Okay. Okay.
I don't know much about this, but it seems
sounds like you do, this seduction thing, you know. This is work for children. The work is for children, not adults. Adults don't do much to play. I love that you would step in like a child.
But I was just saying that he's trying to seduce Thomas into believing what he believes, or thinking as he thinks.
Good. Good. Good.
So let's look at it. I would like you to enter the experience of the work. Turn it around.
Me?
Uh-huh. Say what you said again so you can get a line on it.
Okay. I was just seeing that he was trying to seduce Thomas into believing what...
Good. Now, if you turn it around, I can see that I
can see that I...
am trying to seduce the whole room.
Oh. Into thinking... Right.
Good.
That's nice.
Isn't it? There's nothing more fun than self-awareness. There's nothing more fun than that. Nothing higher. So continue to play with us. Because... We love exposing ourselves here. It's over when we can see it.
Good.
So this also goes for Jorge. I don't like Jorge or any other men who come on to my women friends. It took me a while to really accept that or get in touch with it or realize it.
Yeah. Good.
I don't like it.
So give it directly to Jorge.
Jorge, I don't like you when you come on to my women friends.
Jorge, do you do that?
Yes.
And how does it
feel?
Yes,
I do sometimes.
How does it feel when you do that? What do you want?
I want to be liked.
Yeah, and it assumes we don't like you already.
Yes, it does.
Good. So Tomas, what do you want? You do that to get what?
I like the physical contact.
So why don't you just ask for it?
I do, or non-verbally I do.
Okay, now... non-verbally, that leaves us out. You know, until you start manipulating it, rather than just expressing it, like coming on to us, rather than just ask for it, if that's true.
Thank you.
Yeah. It just cuts out all of the efforting. So how would you ask for it, for physical contact?
I would say, may I touch you, or may I hug you, or may I put my arm on your leg. Yeah.
And we would say yes or no.
Mm-hmm.
So take the risk. But don't enter without our permission for your sake. When you know to do it. Some of us, you could just do that, and it's a nice resonance. You know the difference. We all know the difference. We know when it's going from an integrity to a seduction. Jorge.
I was with my foot and I touched this man a few minutes ago. And I started rubbing his foot. And I realized I didn't have his permission.
Yeah.
I have it now.
Yeah. Another one, one could be appalled and one could say, do the other one.
Yes.
Yeah. So motive is what we're looking at here. And when there is a motive to get something, you're not going to be comfortable with it. And this is about your freedom. It's not about the other person.
And Jorge, I had a story that you thought you were touching my foot and then you realized it wasn't and you stopped.
And I know that I have your permission to touch it.
So how many people in this room have Jorge's permission to give them a foot massage? Yeah.
I set it up great.
So it's my experience that there's a lot of physical contact going on here at the center.
It would sadden me to experience that any staff use people coming home for their own means, that they had not done the work on it where everyone could be. Just step into this high place without experiencing the staff's motives. And so I love that you give this to us, the staff, so that we can live this at a higher level. But without you, how can we? And you've been like staff here, and thank you for that. What we do most mornings is we judge each other, and at every board meeting and at every staff meeting, this is what we do. It's a beginning.
The next one. I want Thomas, Jorge, Michael, and all the men I know to stop fooling around with my women friends.
So turn it around.
I want me to stop fooling around with my women friends.
And again?
And I want me to stop fooling around with all my men friends.
Yeah.
And, yeah, I want me
and to. And just come up and just speak your truth.
Yes, I want me
and
to.
And what's really scary too, you can write it like this and just walk up and say, I've written a piece on you. And I would like, are you available to receive it? And keep your house in order. Because we're not going to be in order. It's for you to be in order.
I mean, is it just...
Yeah, I think it's the men who don't know also.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think it's the whole...
It's everybody,
the whole
right?
bunch.
Yeah.
Yeah. And...
I just got some energy around this my women thing.
Mm-hmm.
And is it true they're your women? I mean, maybe they are, I don't know, but...
Of course they're not.
So you invite your friends to come in here and experience that it's not what you invited them here for. And can you know that?
I
mean, this is
not
for their highest good. Can you know that?
What is not for their highest good?
That they experience what you're describing.
Oh, right. Of course
like
not.
Like someone who hugs them without their permission or gives them a massage.
Of course not.
Okay, so let's look at the next one.
Thomas, Jorge, and other men should not be physical with my moon friends. Okay.
Turn it around.
Shouldn't seduce them. I should not be physical with my women friends. I shouldn't seduce them.
Not without their permission.
Without their permission. Yes, because I lose my integrity if I do.
And how do you seduce them? By protecting them to be the superior one? Is that how you seduce? How do you seduce them?
Mm-hmm. Maybe, yes.
So those of you that are friends of Eric's, women friends, raise your hand. Okay, so how does he seduce you? In your experience?
Yeah, protection, maybe. That's the only... Yeah.
Yeah.
Protection.
Okay. Mel?
I don't feel like you do. I don't feel like he does.
Seduce you?
Yeah.
Good. 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 Do you feel like Tomas takes a shot occasionally?
I feel like Tomas asks for my permission. And then there are times where...
And direct it straight at him. And Tomas.
There are just some times that I love that you're giving love, and it's just a little too much in my space. But you're very receptive to feeling it, and then you move. But I love your love. I love your kisses and everything all the time, so I don't want that to stop. But there are times where I can feel a little bit.
And those of you new to the center, they work in the office together. There are we have several people that work in the office together, and it's
it's the sweetest place to step into, and until it's pristine within us, it's not done. So let's hear the next.
Thomas, Jorge, and others are Don Juans, deceptive con artists, bullshitters, phonies, double-faced mother rapers who only want one thing.
Good. Good. Would you like to thank him for sharing?
I didn't finish the last line. Double-faced mother rapists who only want one thing, to have sex with my women friends and take them away from me.
Mm. So let's hear the reversal.
I am deceptive, con artist, bullshitter, phony, double-faced mother raper who only wants one thing, to have sex with my women friends and take them away from...
From Tomas and Jorge.
From other men. From other men. And
okay, so read. Start in the middle and read it in reverse again.
Double-faced. I am double-faced mother raper who only wants one thing.
To take Jorge and Tomas.
I'm sorry?
I only want one thing, and that is to take Jorge and Tomas.
To take Jorge and Tomas away from my women friends?
Oh,
no?
Yes.
Away? Yeah?
And again?
To take Jorge and Tomas...
Away from myself.
Away from myself, yeah. Yes.
So you use this story to keep yourself from getting close to these two men.
Yes, that's true. And I also get close to that, but that's another story. Yeah.
So that's specifically how you separate yourself from them, and probably a lot of men.
Yes, I am. And I really, you know, when I did this work, I mean, I really saw that this was about my mother and I and my stepfather who took my mother away.
Yes,
I mean, it's very clear. Yeah. And my whole story in my life has been, you know, that the men take away the women in my life. I mean, that's my thing, but... But I didn't want to go into that
Now, they
story.
Can take them away with their seduction. Can you really know that that's true?
No, it isn't. I know.
And what do you get for holding the belief?
I get to hurt. I get to be in fear. I get to be separate.
And you get to hear what Dorothy came up with. You see, that they were yours in the first place.
Right. And my mother isn't mine.
No.
Either.
No.
But I wanted my mother.
Yeah.
And I didn't have her.
Yes.
There's another turnaround there about you taking yourself away from yourself.
You tell the story of what we're doing about the poor defenseless women and the mongrel men, so that you don't have to be
that's
close.
Another one. It just hit something. My poor mother. At the mercy of these guys, not having her own will and her own desires
like
and wishes.
She
it's horrid. Like she, right.
Like
it's
she like didn't.
Exactly.
Yeah. We all know what to do, but we don't do it because we think it's going to cost us something. So, you don't get close to Jorge and Tomas because you think it's going to cost you something. What is it? You're going to lose something or you're not going to get something. What is it?
I do get close to Jorge and Tomas, though.
Mm-hmm. Except for this. This is how you separate.
Except at those moments, yes.
So what is
in
it?
In those moments.
What is it you think you're going to lose?
The woman.
The woman. Like they're yours.
Yes.
Okay, and you hold on to that belief because you think it's going to get something from the women.
Yes. Yes. Yes.
The women.
Yes, their presence. I'll get what I want.
Yeah. And can you really know that that's true?
No, of course not.
Okay.
This is the end of this tape.